I am Professor Anish Vora. I welcome you all in our next series of video lecture. Currently, we are discussing design of three-phase induction motor. And our today's topic is total loading as well as specific loading. Specific loading, we have two different types of specific loading. We have specific magnetic loading as well as we have specific electric loading. So let us first consider total loading. First we consider total electric loading. Total electric loading can be defined as the total number of ampere conductor around the stator periphery is called the total electric loading. So IZ, that is total current through the conductor, and Z, that is total number of conductor. So product of IZ and Z is known as total electric loading. Same way we have total magnetic loading. Total magnetic loading can be defined as the total flux around the stator periphery at the air gap is called the total magnetic loading. The total magnetic loading can be again in equation form, that is product of total number of poles and flux generated per pole. So that is known as a total electric loading. Then we consider specific loading. In design of each electrical machine, the starting point is always to choose both the specific loading. Let us first consider specific magnetic loading. Specific magnetic loading can be defined as the average flux density over the air gap of the machine is known as a specific magnetic loading. So total flux in the air gap divided by area of the flux path in the air gap gives us average value of flux density. So mathematically, in the equation form, it can be derived as product of P and phi, that is our total magnetic loading, divided by pi and dl. Dl is our main dimension. Same way, we have specific electric loading. Specific electric loading can be defined as the number of stator ampere conductor per meter of stator periphery at the air gap is known as specific electric loading. So total stator ampere conductor per periphery at the air gap. And mathematically, it can be derived as product of IZ and Z, that is our specific electric loading, total electric loading, and divided by pi d. D is the diameter of our main stator core. Both this specific loading are important from design point of view. We know that volume, that is d square L, in the last lecture, during deriving output equation, we know that volume is d square L is inversely proportional to the output coefficient. To reduce the volume of active part and so size and cost of the machine, we have to select the highest possible value of output coefficient. Again, output coefficient is proportional to the product of specific magnetic as well as specific electric loading. Hence, we can conclude that size and cost of the machine decrease if increased value of specific magnetic and specific electric loading are chosen. But if higher value of specific loading are chosen, then some of the performance parameters of the machine are adversely affected, like power factor, efficiency. Hence, it is up to designer to optimize the design with minimum cost and maximum efficiency, and at the same time without compromising any of the performance parameter of the machine. So now let us discuss some of the factors which affect the choice of specific magnetic loading. First of all, we discuss about power factor. If we go for a higher value of a specific magnetic loading, we require average higher flux density, and for that we require a higher level of magnetizing current. If higher value of magnetizing current, the meaning is power factor reduce. So in normally we require higher power factor, so higher value of a specific magnetic loading cannot be chosen. Then second, that is iron loss. The iron loss in any part of the magnetic circuit is directly proportional to the flux density, and flux density in any iron part is directly proportional to specific magnetic loading, that is average flux density. Hence, a large value of specific magnetic loading indicates increased iron losses and so efficiency decrease. While choosing specific magnetic loading value, we should always take care that any of the part of the machine should not go into the saturation. Our next factor, that is temperature rise. Increased iron losses indicates a higher heat dissipation and temperature of the machine will increase. If proper cooling is not applied, then temperature may rise beyond a permissible value. So iron losses and temperature rise both increase with a selection of a higher specific magnetic loading. Then we have cost and size of the machine. We just discussed that volume or active part of the machine is inversely proportional to the specific magnetic loading. So with increased value of specific magnetic loading is chosen, then active part or volume or size and hence the cost of the machine decrease. So we have to compromise or we have to trade off between cost, size, and at the same time we have another performance parameters like power factor and efficiency. Then we have overload capacity. A higher value of flux density will give higher flux per pole. If we go for higher or a large number of poles, then for any given voltage, number of turns required will be less and hence less leakage reactance. Less leakage reactance gives larger diameter in circle diagram of induction motor. If diameter of the circle diagram is large, meaning is maximum possible output of the induction motor is higher, and meaning is higher overload capacity. So for 50 hertz machine of normal design, the value of specific magnetic loading lies between 0.3 to 0.6 Weber per meter square. For large overload capacity, 0.65 Weber per meter square value can be selected. So now we discuss factors which affect the choice of specific electric loading. We start with the copper losses. If increased specific electric loading, then copper losses will be more and efficiency of the machine will affected. Next factor, that is the temperature rise. The maximum permissible temperature rise of a machine is determined by the type of insulating material used. With higher specific electric loading, copper losses will be more and the heat dissipation and temperature will rise. So again, we have to compromise in higher specific electric loading. So copper losses will increase, efficiency will decrease, and at the same time temperature will rise and we require better cooling options. So cost and size of the machine, that is our next factor. So again, active part or volume of the machine is inversely proportional to the specific electric loading. So for a higher selected value of a specific electric loading, active volume of the active part will decrease, hence cost and size of the machine will decrease. Then we have voltage. For a machine with a higher voltage, we require more space for insulating material and very less space is available for copper conductor. So for a higher voltage machine, higher value of specific electric loading cannot be chosen. Then we have overload capacity. A large value of ampere conductor will need large copper conductor. So large value of leakage reactance. If leakage reactance is higher, then we know that diameter of the circle diagram will decrease. And if diameter of the circle diagram is less, then we have smaller overload capacity. Hence, the value of ampere conductor per meter depends upon the size of the motor, the voltage of the stator winding, the type of ventilation and the overload capacity desired. It normally varies between 5000 to 45000 ampere conductor per meter. So thank you very much for watching my video. Keep watching my videos. Thank you very much.